We are a direct lender, okay? We're not a broker. So we're just like Wells Fargo or Bank of America, with the exception of we're not interested in opening up a checking account for your borrowers. We're not interested in getting a car loan for them. We are only interested in doing a mortgage for your people. So therefore, we are focused on one thing. We can focus our talents, and we can get the stuff done a lot faster. So we tend to be in more communication with you. If you've ever tried to get a bank loan officer at Bank of America or Wells Fargo, I'm sure you've been frustrated more than once. All right, so I don't know. Let me see. You just go ask if they set it up. I don't know if that means they're actually going. Policy that reduces the amount a lender loss in the event a borrower does not repay their mortgage. It's also called MI, private MI, PMI, mortgaging. Mortgage insurance is generally required on conventional mortgages whose down payments are less than 20% of the property value. So you understand, if they're not putting 20% down, then they will be required to pay mortgage insurance. Most of the time. Why is there mortgage insurance? For many people, saving a down payment of 20% can be a significant barrier to buying a home. In fact, studies have shown it can take 10 plus years given the average income and home prices in the US. Private mortgage insurance, PMI, puts home ownership in reach for millions of qualified borrowers because it helps them obtain mortgages with smaller down payments, in some cases as little as 3%. How does mortgage insurance work? Well, there are several different ways that it works. There are flexibility of payment options. MI can be paid in multiple ways, giving the borrower flexibility. We can offer lender-paid mortgage insurance. We have split premium insurance plans. There's also one-time fees that you can use for mortgage insurance. Cancelability. Unlike FHA, borrower paid MI can be canceled when the borrower reach 20% equity or 80% loan to value. In case you need to know that LTV, that stands for loan to value in their homes. They can do this by paying down the mortgage principal. Another way to get rid of it is as a result of rising home values and due to favorable market conditions. So what that means is, so let's say they originally bought the house and they only put 3% down, but now it's been 3 or 4 years. And the way the payment schedules, the mortgage insurance isn't scheduled to fall off, let's say in this example, till year 8, okay? But they feel like they've done improvements in their house, the neighborhood that they're living in, the sales have gone up. So you can actually contact the person who services your mortgage and ask them what the procedure is to eliminate the mortgage insurance before the time it is scheduled to eliminate. Because when you go to closing,
on my own home?
Yeah.
So we waited the 2-year period and we knew that the home values had gone up, so we requested that a appraisal be done on it, a new appraisal, and they came out, appraised it, and it appraised for, we had well over the 20% equity then, and so I requested that it drop off before the scheduled time.
Which is great, because then she didn't have to do a full refinance. She was able to just contact her servicer directly. Now, each one of them are going to be different. They may have certain time periods that they want, that you have to pay. They may require an appraisal. They may, there may be different requirements. That's why it's important to have your person reach out to whoever's servicing their loan in order to see what the procedures. And in yours, it was just the cost of the appraisal?
Yeah, it was just the cost of the appraisal. A lot of them, I would say, wouldn't you agree, Sean, are 2 to 3 year waiting period for that, right?
Doctor, you're the first person that I know that has communicated with me that had gotten it to be removed prior to the original expiration date.
Yeah.
Nobody ever calls us and says, hey, by the way, we had our mortgage insurance removed,
So. Yeah,
right.
Yeah, but so now we know it
is possible.
Happen. Yeah.
Right, so we go over these options with your buyers because we frequently get those questions. How can we get rid of it without, the 20% down or without paying the 10 years or 7 years, whatever it is?
Now, on my property, when I bought, I didn't do a monthly mortgage insurance like Brittany did. I didn't know that the values were going to continue to rise. I never made money on a house. So I didn't want to take the chance, of
right.
it. So some of the options she's talking about where you don't have, or you can buy out the mortgage insurance, I don't want to put the ball in somebody else's lap, so
right.
to speak. It was up to the servicer to whether or not they were going to remove that or not. And mm-hmm. That's awesome that they did.
Right. Well, and a lot of us lived through the mortgage crash. So, we watched the values go down, and you're not sure, are they rising up the way that they are? So in his case, he opted to do an upfront mortgage insurance, which we'll go in more detail, which is a fantastic way to be able to help reduce the monthly payment for your buyers and more importantly, give them more buying power. Because mortgage insurance can be several hundred dollars each month. So that can make a difference between somebody qualifying for a $200,000 loan or a $250,000 to $275,000 loan. It can make a big difference. So what we try to do is figure out what your buyer's needs are. I'm gonna kind of go off of this a little bit. So when we sit down with your buyers, whether it's over the phone or in person, we talk to them. What are you looking to do? Are you looking to put as little money down? Are you more focused on what your monthly payments are going to be? Are you more focused on the amount of cash you're gonna have to bring to closing? Are you more focused on rate? What is your ultimate goal? And you'll find that most people have a goal. Some are very focused on what they want their monthly mortgage payment to be. Others are very focused on the amount of cash. And then there's some very savvy people who are very focused on not paying mortgage insurance, ways to get around, how to keep their payment as little as possible. So how does mortgage insurance work? MI cancels automatically when a borrower reaches 22% equity or 78% loan to value through a normal amortization when the halfway point of their loan term is reached. So again, if they ask you, well, how do I know what that point is? When they go to closing and that great big stack of papers is an amortization schedule that shows you with every payment what your balance is going to be and at what point the mortgage insurance will fall off on its own. So they do have the ability to look that up.
With 3% down, generally it's almost 10 years. With 5% down, it's usually about 9 years. And it's not exactly this, but it's usually about 9 years. With 10% down, it is about 7 years before it automatically will terminate.
So cancellation can result in a lower monthly mortgage payment or partial refunds of MI premiums, depending on the MI that's selected. How is this different from FHA and VA? FHA mortgage insurance is called UFMIP and monthly MIP. Basically, they're the same things. They just call them potato, potato. They're exactly the same things, although they are calculated different at different rates, but at the end of the day, they're the same thing. On a VA loan, there is no monthly mortgage insurance, but there is called a guarantee fee or a VA funding fee. In for the first time use for a VA buyer, it is 2.15%. And if they're regular military, and subsequent use, meaning a use after that, would be 3.3% of the loan amount, or in most cases on VA, it's zero down, so the loan amount is the purchase price. If there is a VA-related disability, meaning they got hurt while they were in the military, there are ways to avoid that. If they're even 1% disabled from a VA-related injury, that is waived. So we make sure that we're asking those questions when we're dealing with your borrowers if they have the ability to do a VA loan. Private mortgage insurance, or PMI, is for conventional loans. How is this different from FHA and VA? FHA requires on all FHA loans, regardless of the loan to value, that they have mortgage insurance. Okay, so no matter how much they put down, they're going to pay mortgage insurance. And the importance of having a loan officer who can talk your clients through that is that some people come in and they've heard about mortgage or FHA, right? Their friend got an FHA loan, their coworker got an FHA loan. They come down and they sit with Sean or they sit with Brittany and they say, I want an FHA mortgage, okay? Well, we sit down, we do our due diligence, we pull their credit, and they've got 780 credit scores. Right there, I would stop and say, why, you know, can I ask why you think FHA is the way you want to go? And I'll let them explain to me why they think FHA is the way to go. And then I go in and say to them, well, I think I have an option that might be better for you. We can put you in a conventional loan, and with your credit score, the mortgage insurance is going to be significantly less than it is with FHA, because mortgage insurance on a conventional loan is tied to several things. A big part of it is credit score, where FHA is not. If you can have somebody with a 780 credit score come in and do an FHA loan, and someone with a 600 credit score, and they're going to pay the same amount if they put 3.5% down. So why not take advantage of the fact that you've worked that hard to get that 780 credit score? And it ultimately works out lower for them. So it's important that when you're working with buyers, that you have your buyers talk to a skilled loan officer who can actually sit down and explain to them that there are options. Because a lot of buyers don't even know that they have options, and they've spent a lot of time talking to a friend or a parent or a coworker who's done something, and they've convinced them of the type of loan that they should get. While we get them and sit them down and educate them to understand that that may not be the best loan for them.
Yeah, that's a great point. Like with FHA, generally the borrowers that you're going to take FHA is somebody with generally under a 680 credit score.
Right.
You know, usually. Because on the lower credit scores for conventional, like Elizabeth was saying, you know, since conventional PMI is tied to your credit score, it could be significantly higher than FHA. I mean,
correct.
It may be double what
correct.
It is for FHA. So, you know, for your you know, whatever, your 580 to 680 credit score borrowers, usually, you know, FHA
right.
is the best route to go, unless they're doing, you know, 10, 15, 20% down, well then, conventional would probably.
Absolutely. So again, the importance of having a skilled loan professional to talk to your buyers, to go over options with them. Because I find when I've spoken with buyers who have spoken to other lenders, and they say, well, I've been pre-approved, and here's what they pre-approved me for. When I start going through the application, and I'm getting more and more information, I ask them, well, did they say why they put you in that type of loan? I've even had veterans who have been put into an FHA loan because the other loan officer didn't tell them. And a VA loan is absolutely one of the best loans going. No money down, no mortgage insurance, low interest rates. Why wouldn't you take advantage of the benefit? You served our country, we owe it to you. You know, take advantage of these things, and people don't understand. So it's really important that you get in front of somebody who can talk with your buyers and put them in a product that is really going to be a win-win for them and for us. On FHA, the max loan to value is 96.5. So that means the minimum down payment on an FHA loan is going to be 3.5%. Owner-occupied properties only. So they have to live in the property. They can't buy it as a second home. They can't buy it as an investment property. There, with FHA, not only is there monthly mortgage insurance, but there's also a one-time fee that's wrapped into the loan, and that is at a factor of 1.75%. So again, that person who came into my office with a 780 credit score, who wants to do an FHA loan, can avoid that 1.75% by doing a conventional loan.
Which benefits them not at all. Yeah, there's no benefits for them doing FHA in that situation.
Correct, absolutely. It's only more money on their loan amount. So if you can avoid it, why wouldn't you? For the monthly factor, if they're putting down the minimum, it's 8.85%, and then above 95%, it is 0.80. The other way around. If they put the minimum down, it's 0.85. If they put 5% or more, then it's at 0.80. They must hold mortgage insurance for the life of the loan if they put less than 10% down. Okay? So again, I ask you, why would you put yourself into that situation if you didn't have to do that? Okay? LTVs that above 90% will last 11 years. It never cancels on loans with less than 10% down. So again, and most people who are looking for FHA are not looking to put a giant down payment on. They're just not. How is it different from FHA to VA loans? VA, again, owner-occupied properties. They can do 100% financing on VA loans. No monthly mortgage insurance. VA funding fees, again, we went over that. Regular military first-time use is 2.15. Second use is 3.3. If they were in the National Guards, it's 2.4. Second use for National Guards is 3.3. Excuse me. Fee decreased based on the loan-to-value. The lower the loan-to-value, the lower the funding fee, because again, it's a percentage. So if you're putting money down, you have a lower loan amount, it is a lower amount.
And I have one going right now where it was a VA buyer. It was like a $400,000 purchase. They were, have the ability to do, you know, 10, 15% down. So it was his subsequent use. So his loan amount was, let's just say, around $300,000. Subsequent use, 3.3%, is almost $10,000 in his funding fee. So if he did 5% down, that cut that fee down to 1.75% with 5% down, and it cuts it down to 1.5% with 10% down. So that saved him like $6,500 in the funding fee by doing 10% down. You know, not a lot of lenders are going to be covering, correct, you know, yeah, those options. I mean, I've been doing loans for 15 years, and I've been doing VA loans for 15 years, and I'm just going to admit it, I didn't know until probably the last 5 years that if they did 5 or 10% down that the funding fee was cut down. So, I mean, you know, some of these guidelines are thousands of pages long, you know, so knowing everything, I mean, I say all the time, wow, that's the first time that's come up before. Wow, that's the first time that's come up before. But, you know, using, like, polished loan originators that are going to have their best interest in mind is important.
Absolutely. Now, one of the things you heard me say for VA and FHA, it's owner-occupied properties. Now, that doesn't mean you can't buy another property with another FHA loan or a VA loan while you still have a current VA loan. There's a certain amount of, obviously, if you buy one and 6 months later, you go in and try to buy another FHA loan, that's going to be a problem. But if you're a couple of years into it, you're having more kids, you need a bigger house, you're having to relocate for a job, there are certain instances where you can carry two VA loans, two FHA loans, and there are some circumstances on VA where you can have both and still not have to put any money down. They have bonus entitlement. So if you work with a lender that says, oh no, they have to pay the VA funding fee because they already used their entitlement on their first property. A lot of lenders don't know that there is bonus entitlement and there is a way for us to figure out what the new purchase price could be without them having to put down money. So again, having a skilled loan officer that knows the ins and outs of these little things can save your buyers a significant amount of money. How is this different from FHA, VA, conventional with PMI? owner-occupied properties, second homes, and investment homes. Again, second homes and investment homes you cannot use at all for FHA, VA, or USDA. The max loan-to-value on an owner-occupied property is 97%, so the minimum requirement is 3% down. On a second home, the minimum requirement is 10% down. On an investment property, it's 15% down. And the cost of the MI is based on your down payment or your loan to value, credit score, loan amount, property type. So a condominium is a higher risk factor than a single family home. So the mortgage insurance you may find is slightly higher in those cases. Now, there are several options on conventional mortgage insurance that we don't have when you've got mortgage insurance on a government loan. There is an upfront borrower paid mortgage insurance. Now, this number is sometimes staggering when you sit down and you actually work it out. And I've done this several times where I've sat with somebody where they have cash to close. Okay, so we're talking about, and they're payment driven. Okay. And they say, well, what if I put more money here? What if we do this? But they don't quite have enough for 20% down. So there are options where they can do an upfront fee. And I've had where the borrower's mortgage insurance was several hundred dollars a month. And we did the math just for the minimum, which at 7 years, it falling off, which would be best case scenario. And the amount was $18,000 and change. Where we did an upfront, and it was $6,000 to be able to pay it one time and be done with it. And it's a significant savings. I mean, those numbers are powerful when you start to work them out, and people don't realize. So if you've got someone who's just buying the house, they're only gonna be there a couple of years, this might not be the best option for them. But if you've got somebody who's buying their forever home, they waited, this was their dream home, this was the one they saved for, this might be a fantastic option to talk to them about. There is also a way that we can pay the upfront mortgage insurance, the one-time fee. It's called the lender paid mortgage insurance. That tends to carry a little bit higher of a rate, but again, depending on what your buyer's goals are, that may be fit perfectly where their rate is a little bit higher, it still keeps their payment exactly where they want, and then we pay the mortgage insurance. And we've made them happy with their cash to close, we've made them happy with their mortgage payment, and they only thought they were going to be able to buy a $200,000 house, and now I've handed you a buyer who's approved, pre-approved for $275,000. So again, understanding the options that you have, there are some options now that allow you to finance part of the mortgage insurance and pay some of it monthly. There are some that allow you to pay upfront portion and then pay monthly. So, and then there's the traditional monthly paid mortgage insurance. So again, a lot of people didn't have any idea. I did a class over for T-Mobile a month or so ago, and I was talking to them about upfront mortgage insurance, and at the end, the gentleman who had invited us over there pulls me aside and says, I bought 5 homes and not one loan officer has ever talked to me about upfront mortgage insurance. Not one. That's amazing. 5 home purchases. And this has been around for a long time. So it's not like it just came out on the market that somebody might not have known about it. It's been there for a long time, and it's amazing how loan officers will just rush somebody through something without actually talking to them about all their different options.
In the case of an upfront lender, where the lender pays it, where does that usually come into play?
When I'm doing a pre-qualification with somebody and we're going through, but they're not under contract, we're just talking about what they can be pre-approved for, I will talk to them about the different options and we'll kind of go over numbers. But when we get really down to the nitty-gritty is when they're under contract. And then we'll give them more concrete numbers of where they're at with what they're up front. Because when we're pre-approving someone, if they don't already have a house in mind, the numbers could be off slightly, but I always let them know, hey, here's where we're at, here's what we've got the pre-approval, but when we actually go and go under contract, your realtor will send me the MLS, I'll fine-tune these numbers, and then we'll talk about doing an upfront mortgage insurance. Or if you've negotiated closing costs from the seller, this is a fantastic way to offset that upfront mortgage insurance and have the seller pay for it. So then you're not having to pay the higher rate with us paying for it. It's not having to come out of your buyer's closing pocket. It's coming from the seller. So again, finding out what your needs are, if we can work that, that's how we're gonna do it. So we're gonna talk to your buyers about it up front. We're gonna talk to them about the different options, but then we're gonna get more fine-tuned with them as they really start putting in offers and then once they go to contract.
And it's just something to keep in mind too, like in certain circumstances, we have buyers where, you know, they're not even gonna qualify unless they do.
Correct.
Like, to like a no monthly mortgage insurance loan. To say it, but I mean, I have a decent amount of buyers that are buying up to their max.
Absolutely.
And for one reason or another, and I'm, I don't know why your goal would be to go as high as you can possibly go. However, you know, you have people that are in that situation. You know, sometimes it's they don't have a spouse on the loan because the spouse's credit isn't good enough, but they want to use their income. Sometimes they just, you know, want to buy as much as they can possibly buy. So, but you know, we'll communicate with you all. I have conversations every single day,
absolutely,
you know, with agents on pre-approvals. Hey, by the way, listen, you know, they want their payments to be $1,500 a month, but they want to buy something for $300,000, you know, so they only want to do 5% down. Well, you know, if we're doing a monthly mortgage insurance, let's just say that puts them around, you know, $2,000 a month. But if they do a no monthly mortgage insurance, maybe it puts them around $1,700. So it gets them a little bit closer, you know, to where they want to be, even if it's not exactly where they want to be. And in, like, I have one going right now, actually Howard Weinstein, his brother, he wanted to put 20% down. And I was like, okay, but, I mean, that's fine. But I gave him a suggestion where, hey, by the way, what if we gave you an option without doing any monthly mortgage insurance? How about that? And then you utilize those extra funds, you know, whatever, to keep it in another investment vehicle, to pay off, and we have borrowers where they'll pay off an auto loan.
Yep.
So, you know, if you have a borrower with a $20,000 auto loan and a $500 payment, well, instead of putting 20% down on the house, they put 5% down on the house, buy out the mortgage insurance, pay off the car, and that saves them an extra $400 a month.
Absolutely. That happens a lot.
Yeah.
Where people, because the first thing they want to say to us is, well, how about if I put more money down?
Yeah.
It does
that. They think that their monthly liabilities are going to be the lowest, is just putting more down on the home. But like Sean mentioned, paying off large credit cards, student loan, and auto loan is going to get rid of a big chunk of their monthly liabilities, way more than putting an extra 5-10% down.
Because
on the loan.
The credit cards are, you know, some of them are 26, 27, 30% interest. So they could take that same $5,000, let's say, that if they would get to the 20% down, and drop their mortgage payment $30. Or they can take that same $5,000 and pay off a credit card that they're making a $150 mortgage payment on. And this buyer's goals are, I want my monthly budget to be X. So now we've kept them at X, and we've put them in a higher price house than what they thought they could get and still managed to get to X. So again, talking to your buyers and understanding their needs and how to get them to their goals is very important, that you have a skilled loan officer who can help them go over this. Upfront borrower paid mortgage. With upfront borrower paid mortgage insurance, the borrower makes a one-time lump sum payment upfront. This single premium can be paid as part of the closing cost or financed into the loan, so there is no monthly mortgage option. And here's a breakdown. An example, at $250,000, someone with a 720 credit score at a rate of 4.25. So it gives you a good breakdown and the difference between their loan amounts and their payments.
So there, their payment, it's only $200 a month difference, basically, between the two. But they're bringing in $35,000 less.
Right.
So you have a car loan for, you know, 20, 30 grand that you got $500, $600, $700 payment on. Why not get rid of the car loan? And I mean, a lot of times people are still coming out of pocket less money. And everybody always comes to us and says, you know, when we're pre-approving them, right, when we ask what if they want to keep their payments around, oh, less than I'm paying the rent. Oh, less than I'm paying the rent. Mm-hmm. So yeah, everybody obviously always wants to pay less than they're paying the rent, but that makes it harder on you guys, you know, with selling houses, you know.
And in that case, now they're not paying rent anymore. We've got them in a lower paying rent, and they've paid off their $500 a month car loan.
Yeah.
So their whole picture just got a lot brighter. And they're not paying somebody else's mortgage. They're getting mortgage interest too on top of that, which is a tax deduction. So, you know, you've got those buyers that are on a fence. These are some good numbers to show you. And again, I'm going to send this PowerPoint to you guys so each one of you will have this. And this is something you can use to help some of your renters get off the fence, see what we can do. Because a lot of them are like, well, I don't have 20% down. And it is amazing to me how many people call and still think you can't get a mortgage unless you put 20% down. Upfront lender paid mortgage insurance. With upfront lender paid mortgage insurance, the mortgage lender pays the mortgage insurance premium upfront in a lump sum and passes on the cost to the client in a form of a higher interest rate. Again, there is no monthly mortgage insurance. So we kind of talked about that a little bit. And here is an example of that. And again, the savings and the difference of the down payment and then the difference of the cash to close. I mean, these are some very, very powerful numbers. Sometimes you don't even have to do the talking. You can just show them the numbers. Split premium mortgage insurance. Split premium mortgage insurance allows the borrower to pay part of the mortgage insurance up front to reduce their monthly payment along with adding it to their mortgage payment. So in this case, if you've got somebody who's got a good chunk of money they want to put into the deal, but they maybe don't have the entire portion to be able to pay the mortgage insurance. But again, they want to buy a house at $275,000 because they found the one that is their dream home, and this is the one they've been waiting for. And without doing this kind of option, they can only qualify for 2.25. So this is a good creative way of being able to meet your buyer's needs and make them happy and put them in their dream home and still keep it affordable. Because at the end of the day, it's great to buy a home, but it stinks to buy a home and then walk away with no money left in your bank account. You know, what if you want to paint? What if you need furniture? What if you want to upgrade some things? Groceries. You know, you want to be groceries. Yeah, there's always that.
ADD.
Pay the power for that nice new house that you got. You know, so wiping somebody out is not the goal. You know, we want to try to make sure that they can buy the home, they're comfortable with their payment, they're comfortable with their down payment, and then they're still comfortable with a little bit of money in the bank.
Because putting, you know, an extra $10,000 down in the house saves somebody $50 a month.
Exactly.
You know, not much at all. I mean, I think you're better off keeping that money in another investment vehicle. I have a borrower right now that I've refinanced two times, and both times they had paid off their mortgage in full, and they decided they wanted to buy another property, so now I have to do a cash out refinance. And they had just paid off the mortgage, like very recently, and then they decided they wanted to buy another house. So, you know, putting that extra money towards it doesn't always, you know, make sense.
Right, and that's why, again, when I said, you know, if you're doing an upfront mortgage insurance, maybe it's not the greatest plan for somebody who's only going to be in the house for a couple of years. You know, talking to them and figuring out what their plans are, what their goals are, is also part of being able to help them get the house that they want at the payments that they want. So with this split premium, it's 50% of the mortgage insurance is paid up front, and the other portion is financed into the loan. So once again, the monthly mortgage payments, the savings, the cash to close. I mean,
we probably use that one the least, the split premium.
Honestly, I've never used it yet, but I think in the last year started doing this. There was one case when I thought I was going to try to do it, but wasn't able to. But I'm excited about being able to use it. I always like the different products and different ways we can be able to get your buyers in and qualified for what they want.
Yeah, I had never did a financed mortgage insurance premium on a conventional loan up until, I think, like a couple months ago. So, like, I did a lot of the single pay premiums, the lender paid premiums. However, I never did a financed. And if somebody's able to do at least 5 to 6 to 7% down, I mean, it's an awesome option.
Right.
So, and it, until I do something once, I don't like to advertise it. I'm a numbers guy. I was a math major in college, so I like to kind of dive in. And what Elizabeth was talking about, your break even points. You know, all our LOs, they'll go over the break even points where, see if it makes sense to do the upfront mortgage insurance premium or monthly. So, I mean, these guys all know their numbers, and, you know, they're definitely definitely dotting I's, crossing T's, and doing a thorough job.
Well, let me just ask you, how many people knew that you had other options with mortgage insurance before walking in here? Gil, that's because we told you. No. But the room, I mean, Gil's the only one here who knew. So imagine, and you guys are, and you guys are in real estate, okay? Most of the people we deal with don't do even remotely close to what we're doing. And this is significant. So, you know, are you doing your buyers a favor by sticking them with a Quicken loan? Who most, or my favorite, the Rocket Mortgage, okay? Let's rocket it out. Boom, 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 boom. You don't talk to anybody. They jet you out a pre-approval, or they jet you out your payments. They jet, no, nobody talk to them. How do you know that this got you what you really wanted, other than instant gratification? You don't, because again, there's nobody there really talking to them on that telephone. Monthly borrower paid MI. With monthly borrower paid mortgage insurance, the MI premium is paid along with their monthly mortgage payment. MI can be canceled when the LTV reaches 80%, or it automatically when the LTV reaches 75%. 78%. So again, here is an example of the regular monthly mortgage insurance. With 3% down, 20% down, and now in this case we've done FHA with 4% down. So you see the difference? In this particular case, it's not that big of a difference between the mortgage insurance when you're dealing with somebody with a 720 credit score. But again, you know,
but even still, if like you right. look at FHA, so FHA is $40 a month cheaper. However, the mortgage insurance of $170.89 a month lasts for 360 months.
Exactly.
So it lasts for the whole entire 30 years. That's a boatload of mortgage right. insurance that you're going to pay. And you have to pay the financed 1.75% premium. So that times $245,000 is probably around $4,000, which doesn't benefit them once they
absolutely.
So
absolutely.
Conventional still can make more sense even like with a little bit higher of a payment.
Absolutely. So, this is the FHA conventional. How do you make that decision? Again, we've gone over a bunch of different ways that we come to that decision.
I thought there was a quiz.
No, that comes later. So, I like to say this quote, people don't know what they don't know till they ask or till somebody tells them. So, you guys didn't know there was options for mortgage insurance without 20% down before you came in here. Not only did you find out there were options, but there are several options, okay? So again, this is great, but it doesn't always walk your people through what is the best plan for them. And something that I know we do as a team, when we're talking with your borrowers, because a big word that comes up is commission breath. You know, every loan officer, every realtor, they only want to get me the maximum because they're only concerned about their commission. When we're talking with your borrowers, like Sean said, we ask them, what are your goals? What's your monthly mortgage payment? What do you want your monthly mortgage insurance payment to be? Well, this works a lot of, it works for us in a lot of good ways because we still, believe it or not, have those people, like Sean was saying, who come in and say, I don't want my payment any more than rent. As a matter of fact, I want it to be $800 a month. I want a gated community, 5 bedrooms, a pool, I want it in the Steinbrenner, Martinez, school zone. Okay, well we all know that that is not gonna happen. But some people are still living in this world, and if you try to tell them, that's probably not gonna happen. You're commission breath. All you're interested in, you're not, you don't wanna work. You don't wanna find me what I'm looking for, because it's out there, I'm sure of it. So we pre-approve them to their payment that they ask for, and we know they can go higher, so when we're talking to you, after we've spoken with them, we let you guys know, hey, listen, I had a conversation with Mr. and Mrs. Smith. They're maybe not, their goals are not so realistic. Here's what we've pre-approved them on based on what they said they wanted. We both know they're not gonna get it, but let's take them out there and show them what that $600 a month mortgage payment is gonna get them, and then they're gonna have this epiphany. I can pay more than that. And we've already told you that they can't, and they're willing to stretch those purse strings, and we, you guys, weren't the ones pushing them. They came to that conclusion on their own. Because if they're very disillusioned in the beginning, sometimes it takes real proof to show them exactly how disillusioned they are.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because I promise you, they've talked to somebody in their family who bought a house in a foreclosure for $100,000, less than what they said they were. You know, you really have to talk with your borrowers.
Yeah, I mean, I have a borrower right now that the house payment, you know, they don't want to go over $1,000 a month, but they have $1,300 a month in car payments.
No, I do that one.
Did you drill your lender for your car loan this hard? You know, when you went in there looking for a car, you know, to say, hey, I didn't want this monthly payment to be this. You know, it's funny.
It really is. Okay, so conventional loan benefits, higher loan amounts up to $453,001. On FHA, there is a maximum loan limit. So that's why they're saying conventional benefits don't tie you to that lower loan limit. No upfront private mortgage insurance on a conventional loan, so you're not financing that 1.7% or in a VA 2.15 or 3.3. Flexible guidelines on home conditions. Okay, so you hear a lot of times, and this is going to be great for my next class that I'm giving on FHA and VA, or actually I think Brittany is going to be giving that class, that talks about the home condition, that the VA loans or the FHA loans are so much harder. At the end of the day, we're all looking for to make sure that the house is in good shape. So if you're doing a conventional loan and you wrote up an as-is contract, which I love, and there's a hole in the roof, I don't care that you wrote up an as-is contract. That hole in the roof is going to need to be fixed whether you put it under a conventional loan, an FHA loan, a VA loan, a USDA loan. The bank is going to want that fixed. Just because you're doing a conventional loan doesn't mean the appraiser's going to walk in and go like this. I don't see that. I don't see this. I don't see that. It really isn't the case. And a lot of times you may find that an FHA appraisal is exactly the same as a conventional appraisal as far as the repairs. At the end of the day, we want to make sure that the buyers are in a home that is in a good condition, that they're not going to have to immediately have to put a lot of money into. Or, God forbid, they lose and we end up back with it and now we can't sell it because it wasn't up to the condition that it should be. So it's win-win for everybody. I know you see those appraisals and you see those repairs and everything, but at the end of the day, we're making the buyers happy, everybody's happy because those repairs needed to be done. So don't think just because you're writing a conventional contract that is going to get you out of any repairs on a home. PMI cancels when the LTV reaches 78%. No PMI with 80% loan-to-value ratio. Mortgage insurance is less expensive, 0.15 versus 0.85 with FHA. 3% down on a conventional loan. I always go to grab the mouse over here. It is not what I need. All right. Conventional loan disadvantages. Reserve funds are often required, especially when you're doing second home and investment properties. Because if you're going to not make the mortgage payment, which payments are you not going to make first? Not the ones you're living in, the investment properties. So we like to make sure that if you're buying an investment property, you're going to be jumping into that game, which is a great game to jump into. It's a great way to invest money. However, if something happens, we want to make sure that that person has the ability to have a couple of months mortgage payments in the bank if something were to happen. Like you're renting it out and all of a sudden your renter who intended to live there for 5 years just got a job promotion and now they have to move from Florida to Arizona. Can't be helped, they signed the lease, you thought you were good, not so much. So it's important that people who are buying investment properties have some reserves. 620 credit score is required, which is higher than FHA. We can take FHA up all the way down to 580. We don't necessarily like to, but it can go down all the way to 580. Large down payments between 5% to 20%, unless you qualify for a conventional 95%, which only requires 3% down payment. Higher interest rates at lower credit scores, more difficult to qualify than FHA. FHA loan benefits. Low down payments require the 3.5%. The down payment and closing costs can be given as a gift. That also can happen in conventional. But they tend to look at it a little bit more fine-eyed on a conventional loan than they do on an FHA loan. Again, FHA loans are really geared towards first-time home buyers. So maybe those people who are getting, just got married and they got wedding gifts, or their parents are trying to help them buy a house. So gift funds are a lot easier to work with on FHA loans in some cases. Easier to get approved for than conventional loans. Lower credit scores accepted, lower mortgage insurance rates than conventional loans, depending on their credit scores, and reserve funds not required. Again, not that we like to, but we can take them down to nothing on an FHA loan. Not always a win-win situation. FHA loan disadvantages. Lower maximum loan limits, MIP required for the life of the loan if the borrower puts down less than 10%. Mortgage insurance is required even if putting 20% down. Can only purchase condos that are FHA approved. And there is next to nothing that is on the FHA approved list anymore. So, and please, please, please don't believe the MLS. Call, okay? I called on one the other day that looked like it was a freestanding condo, which there are not a lot of those, but those don't have to be on the FHA approved list. So I called the listing agent and said, hey, you know, I can't really tell by the picture, but I see it's a condo. Is this a freestanding condo because it's not on the FHA approved list? He said, oh, I thought I went into the MLS and took that off. I said, no, you didn't. And he forgot. He knew it wasn't there, but he forgot to remove it from his MLS. So, and if you have a lender who doesn't do their due diligence, like I did when I saw the contract come over, and they start them in, they get the, you know, start their earnest money, you're past your inspection periods where now they could possibly lose their earnest money, and then the lender calls and says, oh, my underwriter said that that condo's not on the FHA approved list. He's going to look, I'm going to look, she's going to look, Michael's going to look, and Kevin's going to look. We're all, before that loan goes any further than you emailing it to us and us setting it up for those buyers, we're going to say, stop the presses, because this isn't work. This isn't going to work on FHA.
Same is true, like if it says townhome, like we're still pulling the property mm-hmm. card to make sure that it says property use townhome or villa or PUD or something other than condo. Where if it says condo, we can do conventional financing with as little as 3% down. We get the projects approved with the Fannie Mae standards, but that isn't, it's not a slam dunk. It's not as easy.
Correct.
You know, and depending on the area of Florida, you know, I would say around our surrounding counties, probably about 80%, 85% of the condo projects we get approved.
Correct.
But like down in South Florida, we have some agents down there, and I mean, they're saying it's like, you know, I mean, they're saying, I mean, it's been like 50-50 we can get the projects approved. And we have to do that if they're trying to do less than 25% down on a primary residence, so if you know, trying to do 3, 5, 10% down.
So if you're looking, your buyer's looking at a condominium and you see that there are several up for sale, that, you know, there was a bunch of foreclosures when you're doing your research, there's a good possibility that they're probably behind on their homeowners association dues. They are required to have a certain amount in the reserves. This could be a problem. I had one that one person owned 285 units inside of the complex, and there was only like 400 units. That's a problem. Now, on primary residence, there used to be a certain number of owner-occupied condominiums that had to be there versus second home or investment properties. If they're buying it as a primary residence, that's not as big of a problem as it used to be, but that did used to be a problem. So again, understanding and getting your homeowners association information to your lender fast. Like when you give them the contract, give them the contact for the HOA. So we can start that paperwork right away. So we can write, you know, we may be able to find that it's already on the approved list and that was great. Or we might even be able to pull it up and Sean go, hey, Elizabeth, I just got a contract in that complex where that guy owned 285 units. I don't think I'm going to be able to do it. So we know this way we can look it up and we can try to spearhead that in the front end rather than 2 weeks into the deal, everybody started packing, and now we call and say, sorry, we can't do that.
And you paid for an appraisal.
And an inspection.
And you don't get that money back.
Right, they don't get that money back. And now they're not happy with me, and they're really not happy with you because you recommended me the evil mortgage person who didn't do what she was supposed to do. So again, It is so important that you work with somebody, because our job reflects on you, especially if you recommended us. And it's that way all the way around. And even if the deal goes really smooth right up until that last day, if things go bad that last day, it doesn't matter how great of a job you did for the 6 months working for those people prior to closing, that last day will be the day that they remember. So again, you want to be able to make sure that the lender that you're getting your pre-approvals from will stand behind their pre-approval letters. I had a borrower with an agent that I dearly love, called me late Friday. Guy worked for Raymond James, he was self-employed, he did corporate tax returns, and they just wanted me to get him a pre-approval letter. And I said, I would love to do that for you, but I can't. You're self-employed. I have to be able to see your tax returns. I said, from one professional to another, as a financial advisor, you should understand that I gotta make sure I cross my T's and dot my I's. Now, I'm not saying that's in every single circumstance that we wouldn't be flexible with that, but understand that if I give you a pre-approval letter without looking at someone who's self-employed, their tax returns, because they're giving me the number at the top of the tax returns. I made $500,000 last year. What do you mean you're not gonna approve me? Well, then when I get their tax returns, it's a negative $35,000 because they wrote off all kinds of stuff. Now, there's certain things we can give back, but they're always, 9 times out of 10, they're gonna give me that top number. And not because they're trying to be sneaky or underhanded in any way, it's because they don't know. They really don't know that that's the number that I'm working.
If they have that level of income, they know.
Now, Gil, sometimes they don't. So, you know, it's very, very important. Now, that being said, if you've got a W-2 buyer who's been on their job, they make $14 an hour, they work 40 hours a week, you know, I'm not gonna hold back that pre-approval letter till they get me those pay stubs. At the end of my conversation, I'm gonna say to them, I'm issuing you your pre-approval letter, I'm sending you a list of documents. As long as we can prove everything we said here today, we're not gonna have a problem with your income or your assets, okay? Now, this is the part of the class I always like to talk to you about, our personalities. We are a team, okay? We work together as a team. We are a great team. We are one of the only teams that have kept all our members for the entire time we've been together, and that's because we work really well together. We set it up as a team. We all get paid on all the loans, so you don't have to feel like, oh my gosh, I gave one to Elizabeth, now I better give one to Sean, and oh, I gave one to Sean last time, I better give one to Brittany this time. We're not gonna be mad, but what? Because we set it up that way, so if Brittany started off with that loan and she's working with it, but then Kaysen is sick and she has to be home that day, they call in, I can hop into Brittany's loan and see what's going on. I can answer questions for her buyers. We can work together as a team, so that way we're all together. Now, that being said, that doesn't mean certain buyers' personalities aren't going to mesh better with certain loan officers. So I like to kind of go over the personality chart. This is our rainmaker, Sean Miller. I have been in this business for 20 years. Most of the time, I was a processor, which means I was the little lady behind the handsome man who did most of the work. I still believe the processor does a lot of the work behind the job. But we put it all together and we present the package to the underwriter. As that being said, I have worked with hundreds of loan officers. That is not an exaggeration. Sean is by far the smartest loan officer I have ever worked with. But Sean is a numbers man, okay? Sean doesn't like to chit-chat. Sean doesn't want to hear about the 5 kids, and he doesn't want to hear necessarily about the whole, you know. But he may not work so well with your chatty Cathys, but your people who are investment-based, they bought properties, they got numbers, they want to build like this, this is your man. He's going to get them, he's going to crunch the numbers, he's going to work with those buyers absolutely perfectly. I am the mom, and as you can see by this class, I'm a talker. So I will listen to your chatty Cathys. I will listen to their stories a little bit more. And it's not that Sean won't, because he will. It's just
that, put the phone down.
Yeah, it's just that the personalities may mesh better with, you know, your chatty Cathys, your first-time home buyers. Now, if you've got these people, I am so not the person for this. I am great at what I do, but I like to talk to you. I like to work, you know, I can work the emails, I can work the system. But Brittany is all about the cutting edge, the Facebook, staying on top with the people, communicating on the Snapchat, doing the stuff that needs to be done on those millennials. The people who say things to me and I'm like, hold on, let me call my 18-year-old. What did she just say to me? You know, these personalities may not mesh as well with me, but they would work really well with Brittany. In addition to, Brittany is absolutely, how long have you been doing this?
5.5 years.
5.5 years. She is brilliant. She has jumped into this. And again, as a processor, I've worked with tons of different loan officers. And for 5 years, Brittany is just absolutely incredible. She's an incredible loan officer. She worked with your people who are, you know, math-based. She can work with, as she's a new mom, she can work with your moms, your chatty Cathys. Kevin, he's one of our new guys back there. Now, he's a handsome fella. You know, what young woman isn't going to want to work with this handsome loan officer? He's new to the game, but he is also very good. He's got a great personality. What I like about Kevin is that Kevin really spends a lot of time with your buyers talking to them about what their needs are. Kevin really focuses on answering the questions that your buyers have. He'll come to me and talk to me about a pre-qual and ask questions before they even ask the questions. So he's ready to understand. He wants to be ready to be able to give your buyers the answer. Michael, who is not here, but he is also young, handsome, very much a go-getter, good at what he does, great with this kind of stuff. So what I'm saying is that we've got a personality that will match with every one of your buyers. So you may want to give us a heads up to which buyer you think would work well. I've also posted over here all of our email addresses, Sean, myself, Elizabeth, Brittany, Michael, Kevin, and then if you've got someone who would work with any of us, you can always email the entire team, S. Miller team at Van Dyke Mortgage. Now, how can you get your buyers pre-approved? You can have them call us. We can sit down with an appointment. You can drag them in. However, we can communicate that we have an online application. We'll do early morning appointments. We'll do late night appointments. We'll do Saturdays. We may need some time. As she's a mom, I'm a mom. Kevin, or Sean is a dad also. And on the weekends, we do make plans with our families. But if you give us time, we can make time to come in. Because as we all know, we're salespeople, right? So we don't have a job that runs from 9 to 5. Although Sean would swear that I only work from, you know, 4 to 5. But we are all here flexible. We're all very flexible with our time. We all understand that your buyers have jobs and that they may not have time to work in the normal boxed hours. And they may need someone who will work on a Saturday, who will work on a Sunday, who can come in at 7 and meet with them, or stay on Valentine's Day. I met with someone at 7:30. I was in here having a very romantic prequel at 8 o'clock on Valentine's Day. The three of us, we just loved each other. And at the end, we actually got a pre-approval, so it was a good Valentine's Day for all of us. Does anybody have any questions? All right. Well, thank you very much. I've run 5 minutes over, so I apologize for that.
Just a quick question. Is the PowerPoint available to us to reference?
Did you put your email address on that?
Yes.
Then absolutely. I'm going to make sure that everyone gets a copy of this PowerPoint. Also, if you guys would like to set up a one-on-one appointment, because there's a lot of stuff, questions you may think of that we didn't answer here today, if you would like to set up a one-on-one to meet with any of us, please feel free to sign up. We've got a sheet right here. And again, and even if you don't have an appointment, but you've got some questions, yeah, we are right across this hallway. Come on in. We are always busy, but we always will make time for you guys, okay? Even if the loan is not with us and you're having a challenge with another lender, please come and sit with us because we may have suggestions to be able to walk your buyers through to get them to the goal. And again, thank you guys so much for coming. And if we can help you in any way, we're always here for you.